please welcome ECC Executive Board Member Stephen Hillier.
Good afternoon. I've got the great privilege and distinct honor of introducing General Petraeus, who will be recognized by many. He is a partner in the global investment firm, KKR, and chairman of the KKR Global Institute. He is among the most recognized military leaders of the post-9/11 era, as he notably served as commander of the U.S. forces in Iraq and Afghanistan, and later director of the Central Intelligence Agency. On June 30th, 2011, after Senate confirmation by a vote of 94-0, General Petraeus served as director of the Central Intelligence Agency during a period of significant achievements in the global war against terrorism. During his 37 years in the Army, Petraeus held leadership positions in airborne, mechanized, and air assault infantry units in Europe, the United States, and the Middle East. He has expertise in the arts of post-conflict reconstruction, serving as the Chief of Operations of the United Nations Forces and in Haiti, and Assistant Chief of Staff for Operations of NATO Stabilization Force in Bosnia-Herzegovina. General Petraeus graduated with distinction from the U.S. Military Academy and earned a PhD from Princeton University, and has held academic appointments at six universities. He is currently Global Chairman of the Global Advisory Council of the Woodrow Wilson Center, Senior Vice President of RUSI, and a member of the Trilateral Commission, the Aspen Strategy Group, the Council on Foreign Relations, and the Board of Atlantic Council. He has received numerous U.S. military, State Department, NATO, and UN medals, including four Defense Distinguished Service Medals, the Bronze Star Medal for Valor, the Secretary of State's Distinguished Service Medal, the Combat Action Badge, and the Ranger Tab. He is a master parachutist wings, and he has been decorated by 14 foreign countries. Over the past 15 years, General Petraeus has been named one of America's 25 best leaders by the U.S. News and World Report, the Daily Telegraph Man of the Year, a Time 100 selectee twice, Princeton University Madison's medalist, and one of the Foreign Policy Magazine's top 100 public intellectuals in three different years. General Petraeus is known as the first uniformed person in history to throw the first pitch in a Major League Baseball World Series game and flip the coin at the 2009 Super Bowl game. In 2007, General Petraeus was Time Magazine's Person of the Year, and I'll give you any guesses who he was runner-up to. Vladimir Putin. It's my great pleasure to welcome to the stage General Petraeus.
Thanks for making sure they knew who beat me out for Time Man of the Year.
You're welcome.
I take that personally, actually. You know,
I would as well. Yeah,
I'm doing everything I can to help Ukraine.
Welcoming and joining and leading the discussion with General Petraeus will be our ECC Executive Advisory Committee member Justin Dahl. Justin is a partner with McKinsey & Company in their Houston office and leads a team focused on cost and schedule analytics, EPC market trends, and optimization of project execution strategies, working primarily on the process and advanced industries projects. Justin is a proud Aggie, okay, I was waiting for it, with a degree in mechanical engineering and also holds an MBA from Rice University. Go Owls. And please help me welcome Justin to the stage.
Great job. Have fun.
And thank you, General Petraeus. It's a true honor to join you on the stage.
The honor is mine, sir. Thank you.
As a proud American, I have to say thank you for your service. And as a proud Texan, I have to welcome you. As a proud Texan, I'm happy to welcome you to San Antonio, which fittingly is the military capital USA.
Military city. It's great to be back. A lot of trips here over the years.
Absolutely. You were telling me, as we get started here, you were telling me a great story about why you wore, first, a great colored tie, but an important tie to you. Can you tell the audience a bit about that?
Thanks, and thanks for also wearing a tie. You know, you have to work hard to be retro these days. A tie is a bold fashion statement now. No, I wore this because it is the tie of the British Parachute Regiment. I made a lot of jumps with them back when I was a paratrooper. And I thought it would be particularly fitting the day after the death of the Queen. I had an audience with her one time in Buckingham Palace when I was the commander of the International Security Assistance Force in Afghanistan. And she was very well informed, very sharp, very engaged, very witty, almost at the edge of some of these. I mean, it was really good. I won't repeat some of them, in fact, but it was a real thrill. And you know, at that point in my career, in my life, I'd been doing tons of press and lots of explosive testimony before Congress and everything else. And yet here I was getting ready to go in and just meet with someone one-on-one, and my heart was beating because of the significance. So, you know, she obviously deserves all of the accolades and all of the wonderful statements and reminiscences that everyone has been providing. Truly is the end of an era, and someone who served her country and really her empire, as it was when she first became the Queen, unbelievably well.
And she will, of course, be missed, and she was a great leader, as you are a great leader. And we're going to spend quite a bit of time talking about leadership today. We've told you in our conversations leading up to the conference that our theme this year is inspire. We want to inspire leadership. We want to inspire change. We want to inspire innovation in our companies and across, you know, our capital projects industry. I'm going to ask you quite a few different questions on your opinion on different leadership styles. But first, I think it'd be great if you could give the audience just a bit of your upbringing and perhaps, you know, when you first knew that you were destined to be a leader.
Well, I was born and raised in a little town about 50 miles north of New York. It just happened to be also 7 miles north of West Point. I literally ran home from West Point one time. I mean, legally, I was not AWOL or anything, but it was that close. I think part of the reason I went to West Point was half of the newspaper route customers. I delivered a morning newspaper for 2.5 years when I was a kid, and about half the customers were all either serving West Point staff or West Point graduates. Our high school soccer coach had actually won the national title as a soccer coach at West Point. So you had a huge influence of West Point, the U.S. Military Academy, on our community, and it seemed a little bit natural, frankly, to go there. But, you know, I think you go through life and you're never, at least I was not, you know, I didn't feel like I was destined to be MacArthur from the day that I entered West Point or something like that. But there are moments when all of a sudden you realize, you know what, I think I can do this pretty well. I can compete. And of course you want to compete not just to be the best overall, but to be the best team player overall as well. And there were certain moments, first academically at West Point, where, as was noted, you know, I ended up graduating in the top 5% of the class. And then in Ranger School, where I ended up being the number one graduate. And you start to develop a little bit of inner confidence, I think. And then I found that, you know, I really love the variety of being, in particular, an infantry officer, where sometimes you're under a rucksack, it's seriously physical, it's all about, you know, it's follow me and do as I do, your personal example, your personal energy is of colossal consequence. And as they say, you can't lead from the rear of the formation, you gotta be up front. But then there are elements that are very cerebral. They require, again, all the tools that you can possibly bring to bear from your academic background. I was very fortunate to be able to go to graduate school, although I was told when I was decided to go to Princeton that I was committing professional suicide, that I should go to the Ranger Regiment instead of, and I said, okay, I'll have to take my chances, but I think I need to raise my intellectual sights a bit beyond the maximum effective range of an M60 machine gun. So anyway, and then you discover that, hey, I can do that stuff pretty well too. And then you get the leadership component, which so many in here know is so, you know, it can be so unbelievably challenging. Leadership has the highest of highs and the lowest of lows. That's particularly true in leadership in combat. And I think, as was noted, I had 5 combat commands as a general officer. So we experienced all of that. But that mix of this, if you will, the physical, the leadership, the cerebral, the academic, the intellectual, I think there are very few places that put a premium on each of those in the way that the military does, noting that, yes, the physical is a lot more important as a young commissioned officer than it is later on and so forth, although it's still nice to be able to give the troops a run for their money, literally. By the way, there is someone in here yesterday. He was in the fitness center, and he made the mistake of asking how many dips I could do, you know, the up and down dips. And I gave him the same response that I always gave to my soldiers when they asked me, and the answer is, one more than you, big guy. Actually, yesterday I did, I think it was three or five more than he did. He looks a lot better than I do, I should note. He has much bigger guns. He looks great. But beware of the little guy that has a little bit of strength. Anyway, but you know, this mix of this stuff I just found wonderful. And there's nowhere else where I couldn't think that you could get quite that same mix. I felt privileged to be doing what I was doing, and that just grew every year that I was in the military. And then obviously to be unbelievably privileged to have the leadership opportunities at critical moments like the surge in Iraq. You know, Texas's own George W. Bush calls you up and tells you, you know, I want you to go back to Iraq again, and you're going to lead the surge. That's a pretty big deal.
Absolutely.
So, and I said, you know, the only answer to a question like that, Mr. President, is yes.
So our ECC Lifetime Achievement Award winner, John Zachary, who won the award yesterday, talked about finding his motivation for being a leader. How do you motivate yourself and those that are working with you, especially in crisis situations like the surge in Iraq?
Well, first of all, I think you have to have a degree of competitiveness. And again, you, as I said, you have to temper that competitiveness so it's not just about you individually or even just about your own unit. It has to be about the greater organization. As I said, you want to compete to be the very best and also to be the best team player. And again, I have more than a degree of competitiveness. My aide, when I was a division commander of the great 101st Airborne Division, told some journalists that, yes, he is the most competitive guy in the world. And I think that helps. But you have to truly want to be the very best that you can be. And I know this sounds very, very trite, and we all say this, but you really have to do that. I'm often asked, what would you want to tell young people about life in general? And I'd say, life is a competitive endeavor. And you don't get a trophy just for showing up. This is not kids' soccer. You don't get t-shirts just because you're there. You get it because you are the best. And you may not win everything. You're not going to, clearly. You know, life is not full of endless high-five moments. And really, the true test is actually how you do when you get knocked down or you knock yourself down or what have you. But at the end of the day, you've got to have a fierce competitiveness and focus and drive and determination. And you're just not going to take no for an answer. You're going to figure out how to get it done. Even in graduate school, you know, they'd never had anybody in 2 years do all. I had to get a master's degree first. That was a professional degree. And then I wanted to do all the coursework, general exams, oral exam, dissertation prospectus, language exam, and everything else simultaneously. And they just said, you can't, as it's not physically doable. And I said, okay, watch me. And I learned the rules better than they did. And eventually there was a course conflict. I couldn't actually take the course because there was another required course at the same time. They were sort of happy about that because they want you to take 4 years at least to do this stuff. And then another 4 years to write your dissertation. I said, I've got 2 years here. That's all the Army's going to give me. Yep. And in the rule book, it said if you get an A- or better in a final exam, even if you never set foot in the classroom, you get credit for the course. So I studied like you wouldn't believe. I went to see the professor, got the lecture notes, and you know, rolled the dice and got an A-. But you just got to have that kind of fierce desire and determination and competitiveness. And that's no news to the leaders out here. That's how you get forward. And again, especially for those who are again in the industries that surround Houston, where you've had these massive ups and also massive downs. I mean, when you're stacking the drilling rigs, it's not a happy time to be a leader. But you gotta get through that, and you do, and you come out the other side, and you're better, actually, in some cases, for having had that experience. So there's got to be inner drive, inner determination, inner competitiveness. You may try to play it down. You may make it look like, you know, you have a light hand on the reins or whatever. I don't think that's really the case typically in great organizations. You have to drive a campaign plan, whether it's in peace or in war.
And leaders often have to drive change, right? And you had to drive
a big change with the
surge in Iraq.
Yep.
How did you make that happen?
Right. Let me talk about that, because this intellectual construct, which we built while I was a fellow at Harvard for 6 years. So at the belfercenter.org website, if you Google Petraeus on strategic leadership, it lays out a construct for strategic leadership. And a strategic leader is the person at the very top of a company, an organization, a military unit. Usually just one, although you can often have co-CEOs as we have had at KKR historically and have again now. But that person, and by the way, it can be a startup founder with just a couple, you know, just people that'll sit around a dining room table size, or it can be, when I was commander of US Central Command, the greater Middle East with 250,000 soldiers, sailors, airmen, Marines, you're the strategic leader. And you uniquely have to perform four tasks correctly, but particularly the first task, which is to get the big ideas right, to get the strategy right. The direction, the concepts, all of this stuff. And for what it's worth, I never was one that could find the right tree to sit under and get hit on the head by Newton's apple fully formed. In other words, the big idea just pops into your mind. I get hit on the head by a kernel of a big idea or a seed of a big idea, and then interactively, openly, transparently engaging everyone that you possibly can, because you want everybody inside the tent, because you know what happens if they're outside the tent and what they do to those inside. And you build these big ideas, then you have to communicate them to the breadth and depth of the organization. If you're commanding the surge, you have to communicate it to the White House too, and to the press and Congress and all of your coalition country leaders, et cetera, to the host nation, prime minister and people. That's task two. Task three, this is what we normally think of as leadership. This is overseeing the implementation of the big ideas. This is giving energy, providing example, inspiring, motivating, rewarding, incentivizing, attracting the very best people, developing them, retaining them, allowing some of the others that aren't measuring up to move on to something else. It's how you spend your time, your battle rhythm. It's a crucial component of strategic leadership because, again, how you spend your time shows what you think is important. It's the metrics. Are you winning or losing? Are they accurate? Have you wrung them out? All of these issues, again, it's the leadership style that constantly has to evolve depending on the individual in whom you're trying to bring out the best and so forth. And then there's a fourth task that is often overlooked, which I think has to be done formally, and that is you sit down. It was on my battle rhythm in various different ways. You sit down and you determine with the help of others how you need to refine the big ideas or adopt new big ideas and discard old ones so that you can do the process again and again and again. If you think of Kodak, which was the most important company in film photography and all aspects of that, they had 2,000 patents on digital photography, but they failed to perform task number four properly. And others got to digital photography before they did. Others made digital photography the big idea for their company before Kodak did, and Kodak ceased to exist as we know it. So you've got to get that. But to come back to innovation, it starts, obviously, by getting the big ideas right. And there's, you know, there's little ideas, there's all kinds of subordinate ideas, and there's big ideas about not just the overarching endeavor of a company also, but about all kinds of other practices. But at the end of the day, again, if you don't get those big ideas right, it doesn't matter how charismatic, how energetic, how inspirational, whatever it is you are, it's just not going to work. And this is, I think, very, very true, not just of the surge in Iraq, where the big ideas were 180 degrees different. You know, you talk about change management. Hey, we're going to do the exact opposite of what we've done for the last 18 to 24 months. And by the way, it was over the objection of the individual I replaced. So we're going back into the neighborhoods, which we've been giving back to the Iraqi security forces and handing off to them and consolidating on big bases. We have to go back and live with the people because that's the only way we can secure them. That's big idea number one. Big idea number two, we're taking back control from them. Big idea number three, we have to reconcile with as many of the rank and file of the insurgency, because you can't kill or capture your way out of an industrial strength insurgency. You have to, again, take as many off without having to kill or capture them. We're gonna integrate civil and military even more. We're gonna have a civil military campaign plan, not just a military one and a diplomatic one. It's all gonna be together. I mean, these are pretty big ideas. And by the way, the biggest of the big ideas were opposed by the Prime Minister of Iraq, and we had a big standoff in the first couple of days, and he backed down. And I told his national security advisor that if he did not back down, I was gonna leave, I was gonna go to Washington, I was gonna tell President Bush that we could not accomplish the mission, and I was gonna resign my position. That is a strategic leader moment, and I did not sleep that well that night until I realized that I was never gonna hear about it again, and he was gonna let us do what we needed to do. This is very applicable in the civilian world as well, in the private sector. I think Reed Hastings, until recently, has been flawless at, of course, he's the CEO of Netflix, who took them from really their beginnings all the way to this extraordinary firm that they are, although he is now having to rediscover, redesign, find new big ideas, because finally they've reached the point at which their revenue and their the number of customers and so forth is not climbing the way that it was. But think about Netflix. The first big idea is we're gonna get movies in the hands of customers without brick and mortar, i.e. no Blockbuster, we're gonna undercut them. And they do, they do this whole process. Big idea number two, Blockbuster is going out of business. You know, it's only left now in Big Bend, Oregon. They refuse to let their Blockbuster store die. They're famously contrarian. Big idea number two, now broadband speeds are fast enough, so we're gonna have them download movies. Work through that, that's great. Big idea number three, let's develop our own content. Remember, that was such a revolution. And this is Breaking Bad, I think, or is one of them, and then a couple of these other really seriously iconic ones. You know, $100 million on House of Cards alone. And that all pays off. And then the fourth one was, he decides, now we're gonna go into the real serious moving picture business, and we're gonna buy a couple of studios, and we're gonna make our own movies. And they had more Academy Award nominations than any other, although this is where I should note, as I have mentioned to him, I still take it very personally that the first one they did where Brad Pitt played General McChrystal was worst ever part for Brad Pitt, who played it like a little wooden soldier. Stan McChrystal isn't like that. He has a sense of humor and all this stuff. But beyond that, I was just devastated that Brad Pitt did not play me.
So I've heard you describe Iraq as a surge of ideas, right? And you just talked about all these big ideas.
The surge that mattered most was not the surge of forces. That was hugely helpful. I mean, we never could have implemented it as fast and gotten the results that we needed within 6 months before I went back to Congress. So I didn't have results at that 6 month set of hearings. It was game over, lights out. And so that was huge. But the real surge was the surge of ideas. It was these new big ideas that I described. Yep. That was the key. Yep. If we'd done the same thing we'd been doing, we would have continued to fail.
And your post after Iraq was in Afghanistan. And I've heard you say—
After Iraq was Central Command, but then came Afghanistan.
Excuse me. But I've read that, you know, in Afghanistan, you didn't expect the same outcomes in Iraq.
You could not. And I told Congress, I really did truly believe that we were going to be able to do what we accomplished in Iraq. I was not 100% certain that we could do it in the 6 months. And if we hadn't, then we could have had trouble. When I remember, I came back with Ambassador Crocker for a pretty explosive, emotional set of hearings. But I did believe we could literally do what we did, which was drive violence down by 85%, you know, give the land of the two rivers, Tigris and Euphrates, give Iraq a whole new opportunity, which is what our soldiers, sailors, airmen, Marines, and civilians did provide for them. And it actually went quite well for the next 3.5 years until we pulled our final combat forces out and the Prime Minister of Iraq made some very catastrophically bad decisions and undid and allowed the Islamic State and all the rest of that. But Afghanistan, I'd actually gone to Afghanistan as well. Secretary Rumsfeld had asked me to do an assessment there also on my way home from the three-star tour in Iraq, where it also extended me. And I said, Mr. Secretary, you know, that's not on the most direct route from Iraq home, but okay, I got it, we'll go over there. And I came back and I laid out, of course, you know, in a PowerPoint briefing, that's what generals have, it's how we communicate. It's part of our inalienable right, freedom of expression aided by PowerPoint. And the very first slide was titled, Afghanistan Does Not Equal Iraq. And it laid out all the ways in which it was different. By the way, at that time, it was much more peaceful. It never, ever had the levels of violence that we experience in Iraq, which were out of control. You know, when you have 53 dead civilian bodies due to violence every 24 hours in the capital of a country, you got problems on your hands. And that was the situation in Baghdad right before the beginning of the surge. Nonetheless, the fact that the enemy had sanctuaries in the neighboring country, in Pakistan, the fact that they had no money, they had no infrastructure, they had no education, it was just so much that was very, very different from Iraq, meant that the best you were probably going to do in Afghanistan was to manage the situation. You couldn't win. But I actually really thought that managing was better as an alternative, candidly, than what we did end up doing. I should note, I don't even register to vote, much less vote, align with a party, support candidates or contributor, anything like that. And I was very, very critical of the current administration over the decision to withdraw, which of course was started by the previous administration, but to follow through, and then obviously the way that we did that. I felt there were legitimate, decent alternatives. And I think I said after that decision was announced that I feared we would come to regret the decision, and I think we have. We've consigned a country of 40 million people to a ninth century of ultra-conservative Islam in which 50% of the population can't even go to high school, much less college, much less participate in the economy, society, et cetera. Be that as it may, again, the differences were so profound, and you have to understand the context. As you all know, again, and some of this is also, there's a timing issue, as you all know as well. Again, it's pretty easy to be a leader when the price of oil is $105 per barrel. It gets a heck of a lot tougher when it's down around $30 per barrel. And again, when the drilling rigs are stacking up once again. So it was just profoundly different. And we never, you know, we didn't in Afghanistan even get the inputs right. I'm talking about the right big ideas, the right strategy, the right level of resources, the right organizational architecture to implement that strategy, the right preparation of our forces and leaders. The right levels of diplomats, development workers, spies, their preparation, all of this, we didn't even get right until 9 years after we invaded that country and toppled the Taliban in order to eliminate the sanctuary that Al-Qaeda had under the Taliban in which the 9/11 attacks were planned. It's really tragic that we squandered those years. And this is multiple administrations. And then we never were even consistent within an administration, much less between them. None of the four administrations, ultimately, were consistent even within their term in office. Trump was much more forceful for 2 years and then did the diplomatic deal that was the worst in our history, I think, without the Afghan government even being at the table for discussions about their own country.
If I move forward a little bit,
yep.
You're now in the private sector, 10 years at KKR. What has that transition been like, you know, out of the military into private equity?
It's been wonderful. I think clearly that the highest calling in life outside of serving in government is the private equity industry. Work with me. I thoroughly enjoy. KKR has the most talented workforce with which I've ever been privileged to soldier, to work, what have you. It's just really extraordinary. And I've been a partner in that firm during a period when we've gone from $83 billion under management to nearly $500 billion under management. We own about 110 companies around the world. And then we have minority interests in another 100. I've done this at a time when we've gone from what we could describe as an era of benign globalization, in which economics largely drove geopolitics, to now an era of renewed great power rivalries in which geopolitics determines what is possible economically. So we are central, because again, I don't do the financial component of this, obviously. I do the geopolitical risk identification and then identifying how it is that we can mitigate those risks, or in some cases saying we should not do this deal. And I've vetoed several deals over the year, literally, even though the financial aspects were very attractive, but said that there are risks that we should not take. We're investing people's pension funds, and we're very serious about that. So intellectually, it's been incredibly stimulating, challenging. They're happy to have me do academic endeavors, stuff like this, which is great fun. I'm also an investor in 25 startups. And I love that because you come back to the leadership component. You know, what you look at in a startup is what we look at in our big investments. What's the quality of the leadership team? What is the power of the big ideas? And can that leadership team scale those big ideas? And of course, help it grow. And that's what we want to help companies that we buy or invest in do as well. And it's been a wonderful, it's been absolutely, again, at my stage in life, I think what you're looking for is intellectual stimulation, rewarding work, important work, and this fits all of that. I'm only partly joking about the fact that it is, it really is. I feel quite passionate about what it is that we do because we help companies and we help them grow. We have big office in Houston. We own a lot of the Permian. I've been out to Midland. Somebody joked at that time that the only things in Midland, and this was about 5 years ago, were roughnecks and private equity. I was obviously the private equity. So it's been terrific. I have thoroughly enjoyed it. I'm in the boards of a couple of the companies that we own as well. And again, you get up in the morning and you're fired up about what it is you're going to do. It involves a lot of travel. I don't find that overly difficult. And I don't golf. So it's good. I mean, golf, I know this room is probably full of golfers and, we're surrounded by a PGA course and another course for those that can't do the PGA course. Golf is a good walk spoiled. Go to the gym.
So let's talk about some of those big risks, right? There's many of them out there. And maybe if we start with Ukraine, obviously you're frequently on the news speaking about that.
Look, I think it's very exciting to see what's happening in Ukraine. Literally in the time that you have been here, Ukraine launched a second counteroffensive that is succeeding unbelievably. They clearly caught the Russians by surprise. Now, keep in mind, let's go all the way back to the beginning. I think most people thought that the Russians were going to roll right over them. I did not. I said in the Atlantic, in an article, that the Russians would not take Kyiv, much less ever control it and topple the government. And they proved that to be correct. I've been to Ukraine a number of times. Most recently was after President Zelensky was elected. I've met with their military on the front lines previously and all the rest. And I was pretty convinced that, especially when you get into urban areas, the Ukrainians are going to stop them cold, and they did. So the Russians lost the Battle of Kyiv. They lost the battles of two other cities in the north. They then concentrated on the east, the southeast, and the south, coming out of Crimea. They did have some success there, but the Ukrainians made them pay an enormous price for that. The Russians were losing more in a single day, day in, day out, than we lost in the worst month of the surge in Iraq. These are huge casualties, and they can't replace them. And so the Ukrainians did all that. We piled on. We have provided. Now, I was critical of the administration and what they did in Afghanistan. I'm very impressed by what they have done on Ukraine, not just providing all that we have, but keeping all of our NATO allies and partners together. It's pretty helpful if you have the kind of threat that Putin poses to Europe. He set out to make Russia great again, and what he's really done is make NATO great again. And it's really extraordinary to see the cohesion that I'd not seen since I was a speechwriter for the Supreme Allied Commander during the days of the Cold War. So we knew that the Ukrainians were going to use this avalanche, this mountain of weapons, effectively at some point. First, they were going to use it in the south to try to get rid of the Russians that are on the west side of the river, the Dnipro River that cuts Ukraine really in half, west and east. They've been doing a brilliant job using these precision munitions that we have provided in particular to pick off the Russian headquarters, ammo supply points, fuel depots, troop assembly areas, barracks, everything. They're just really taking it out and forcing it all to be pushed much further from the front lines, which makes it much less responsive. And they're isolating that battlefield, and they're gradually eating away at the Russian presence. And that's about as predicted. That's sort of, again, urban combat as you get into the villages, getting closer to the major city there, Kherson, K-H-E-R-S-O-N, it's going to be hard. Meantime, though, just 3 days ago, they launched this other offensive just to see what might happen up around Kharkiv, the second largest city, which they also kept the Russians from taking, right near the border. And all of a sudden, they just started rolling. And the Russians were completely surprised. The Ukrainians captured a three-star general yesterday, I think it was. So, and they're threatening the major line of communication that comes into eastern Ukraine from Russia. So this is very exciting. Look, make no mistake about it. This is about as black and white as it gets. This is good versus evil. Putin is a kleptocrat, a brutal, vicious, barbaric kleptocrat. And the Ukrainians are a democratically elected government. Yeah, they've got their issues, and yeah, there's oligarchs, and yeah, there's corruption and other issues, but they're trying to reform all that, and they believe in the free market system and so forth. They are our surrogates, and we need them to win, and I think they actually can. So it's very exciting right now, and as you all unplug from this and get back caught up, you're gonna be astonished at what has happened in the East, and to see how far that might go is really exciting for somebody who's been, I can actually, because of the social media, I mean, this is the first war ever fought where everybody has a smartphone and all kinds of social media sites under which you can upload your photos, your videos. The Ukrainian units actually compete with one another for the best videos. I'm not joking. I mean, there's all websites on this. And they show, yep, there goes another Russian tank. And you know, the signature strike of this war is they hit a Russian tank and the turret actually blows up and off and lands next to it on the ground because the Russians still, to this day, have not designed the turret in a way that separates the ammunition from the rest of the turret, as we have. We have a blast door. And so once, if you get it to ignite, it literally, the ammunition just blows the turret right off. And obviously the Russian soldiers get out of it very, very quickly. This is an extraordinary, to be able to follow this with open source intelligence, as the term goes, because of all that, is really exciting.
If we shift a little farther east and talk about China.
Yep.
What are your views on where China is going, the interactions with the US and...
Well, China, look, first I should say, obviously, no one wants to see as mutually beneficial a relationship as is absolutely possible than does someone who has seen what happens when we go to war. That said, this is the challenge of our lifetime. The rest, I mean, we've got Islamist extremists, basically. We know now that we just need to keep an eye and pressure on them. You're not gonna defeat them or solve the circumstances that give rise, but you can keep them sufficiently down that they can never carry out a 9/11 or that kind of attack on our allies or partners either. North Korea, we're deterring. Russia will deal with. Iran is another whole set of problems, and we're working our way through that. That is the challenge in the Middle East. But at the end of the day, the history of this century is largely going to be defined by the relationship between the U.S. and China, and the U.S. and all of our allies and partners with China. I was mentioning earlier, the U.S. uniquely in the world is like the guy in the circus who gets a plate spinning, you know, and then he gets another one spinning, and pretty soon you have a whole circus tent full of plates. These plates represent the threats, the challenges. And keeping them spinning means you're dealing with them. The China plate is bigger than all the other plates in the entire tent put together. We are fortunate to have allies and partners that help us keep that plate and many of the others spinning. But at the end of the day, if we don't do it, all the rest of them come down. We saw, we pulled out our 3,500 troops from Afghanistan. The allies pulled out 8,500. They can't stay if we're not there. So again, this is the defining relationship of our time. I actually think, again, that there has been really quite good bipartisan consensus. I think this is where you give the previous administration credit for it really changing the entire approach to China, changing the conversation, recognizing clearly the challenge that this presents. And then this administration has largely continued it and tried to get our allies and partners more back into it to create a comprehensive, integrated whole of governments with an S on the end approach to China, which is what is needed. We're taken off course a bit, again, by the withdrawal from Afghanistan, but then got back on that. And again, we have to have very clear eyes about this. This is a much more aggressive, wolf warrior diplomacy, economic coercion, intellectual property theft, beating up Indian soldiers on the line of actual control on the roof of the world. I mean, this is an aggressive country who will have now a president for life. He's going to be reelected as the party leader in mid-October, and then will also automatically become the president for a third term and the head of the military commission as well. And we have got to convince them. We have to deter, above all, action that could lead to conflict, principally over Taiwan, but over any of the other disputes that exist in the South and East China Seas, the Yellow Sea, and so forth. This is the task of our time. And deterrence rests on two components. They are the potential adversary's assessment of your capabilities, on the one hand, and we have to work hard to get those capabilities to what they should be, to shore up deterrence. By the way, that also includes actions that Taiwan needs to take very significantly. And then the second is the potential adversary's assessment of your will, your willingness to employ your capabilities if it comes to it. That's another reason why Afghanistan was dangerous, because it allowed President Xi to say, see, we told you, you cannot count on the Americans. And look at how they left. They're a great power in decline. I think we have pushed that into the rearview mirror by the very effective way we have supported Ukraine. Again, bipartisan, make no mistake about it. The greatest champion of Ukraine on Capitol Hill is the minority leader, Mitch McConnell, who's very strongly, he's not going to allow his caucus to oppose what the administration wants to do just because they're of a different party. So this is the challenge of our time. And frankly, we spend more time, and I'm sure a lot of you spend much, much more time than we ever did before, ensuring that we are investing legally, but also properly in China, and that we're doing the same with investment that comes from China. We're the biggest investor of our type in all of Asia. And so therefore, we've got to be sure that we do that right. And we want to invest responsibly for our country. We are a U.S. firm.
The geopolitical issues that you've mentioned, Ukraine and China, are having a big impact, plus the pandemic, on supply chains.
Big
supply
time.
Chain resiliency.
Yep.
But with your role at KKR, what are you seeing, you know, as far as the investments KKR is making or their portfolio companies, and how are they strategizing around?
Well, the issues about supply chains have been really pronounced. I mean, first of all, we were reminded that you shouldn't have everything assembled and manufactured in the same location in the world, because if that location shuts down because of zero COVID policy, no Apple Watches get built for 5 weeks. So you have to have, again, you have to have dispersion, you've got to have, again, resilience, et cetera. But there's a whole host of other issues that have been going on in this realm as well. Rising labor costs in China, so you go to Southeast Asia, or you bring it home. The rise of the robots back here. You don't need as much labor as we used to. So you can do the manufacturing and assembly here in some cases. I mean, there are numerous issues here. Now there are much greater national security issues. There are export controls on microchips. So as I mentioned earlier, it used to be the economics determined geopolitics. These weren't big issues. Now they are central, and you have got to get that right, and it's why we have, you know, a risk committee that focuses on these in the macro. And by the way, everything that I do is always partnered with the macroeconomic team, and then the environmental social governance team, rule of law being very, very significant. By the way, big concerns just south of the border here, growing concerns because of the populism of the Mexican president and because of the erosion, further erosion, of security and rule of law in a country that otherwise would have benefited enormously. They still will benefit, but nowhere near what it would have been if people felt comfortable making increasing investments there as opposed to perhaps doing it elsewhere in North America.
If I pivot back to this idea of innovation, one of the things when I was doing research on you that you said was on intellectual capital, and that at Princeton getting your PhD, you studied Vietnam because you thought it would be a useful piece of intellectual capital, and it turned out to be a much later, but it was a very useful piece of intellectual capital. So how do we go about thinking about intellectual capital, acquiring it, and using it to our benefit?
Well, again, I think, again, the leaders here know that you can't live off the intellectual capital that you've built from your own foundational academic endeavors and then your early experience. You've constantly got to be updating it, refreshing it, adding to it, and so forth. And, you know, people ask me, God, why are you running around? I mean, why are you teaching? I'm teaching at Yale now, right now. And I was a fellow at Harvard for 6 years. I taught once a week at the Honors College of the City University of New York. I had a chair at the University of Southern California for a 1 week, a semester chair out there for 6 years. You know, why are you doing all this? I can't even, as a partner, I can't even accept money for it. So I don't even get paid for what I do for the students at Yale. Well, it's number one, I love the interaction with young people. I love being challenged by them, but I also love, this is an action forcing mechanism to force myself to stay current. I only teach courses that I can draw on. I want to build intellectual capital that I can draw on still. And I think I'm sure that's the approach that so many of you have. And more importantly, that you are using in your firms that kind of concept to help your employees continue to grow, to develop. You know, the whole idea of just sort of endless learning and all the rest of that is crucially important, especially at a time when technology is moving as rapidly as it has been and is going to actually accelerate undoubtedly in the years that lie ahead.
You mentioned technology and acceleration, right? So one of our challenges that we see as an industry is that we need to do all the things that we just discussed, developing leaders, driving change, innovating, and we need to do it faster. And so what advice would you give us on how to approach that?
Be more efficient, be more productive, really it is. Work harder. There's no magical solution to any of this. It is how do you structure, again, what you're doing, how do you use your time to max productivity? And, you know, when I had some of these really big jobs, we added a very elaborate structure to support me. I had 4 and 5 speech writers at a time. I had 4 or 5 correspondence writers at a time. We had 2 people that did nothing but schedule day in, day out. I mean, just 2 of them full time. And in the war zone, 7 days a week. We had, you know, you got aides, you have assistants, executive officer, you have security. And everything is set up so that it is so productive. And when you're doing that, if you have that kind of elaborate structure and you use it properly, I mean, we'd do 5-minute meetings. And the people that were the subject of that 5-minute with me, I hope, you know, felt very special as a result of that. And I had my talking points, we had the medal, we had this, we had that, the family's there, we've made sure they had an elaborate process to get to you, you know, they get to go through the CIA museum, they do this, they do that. And this is the culmination of a memorable experience for them. That's, again, that's how you do it. That's how you, and it's all about, again, using time as productively and efficiently and effectively as is absolutely possible. We had a huge butcher board piece of paper that showed this is what I do every single day of the week, because in combat, again, it's 7 days a week. This is what we do a couple of times a week. This is what we do once a week. This is every other week, monthly, quarterly, you know, all the way up. The culmination each quarter was a six-hour combined campaign plan, civil-military campaign plan review. And you just ground through. I hated those days. That was the one day where I woke up that I was not as fired up, because you're going to sit as people are going to PowerPoint you to death. But this is how the ambassador and I drive this campaign plan. And by the way, it's an action forcing mechanism for them, because they know they're going to face us and we're going to be all over the subject matter that they're talking about. And keep in mind, by that point in time, I'd already had 3 years or so on the ground. So I knew a little something about Iraq. You know, people, by the way, used to say, oh man, it must be so tough to go back to Congress. That's really, really tough. I know something about Iraq. Bring it, you know, give me your toughest shot. It was great going toe-to-toe with people in Capitol Hill with the cameras rolling. I mean, that's, you gotta up your game, and you gotta have your game face on.
Well, we also have to recruit and attract talent, mm-hmm. Which is a challenge facing our military as well.
Yeah.
What are some lessons that we could learn?
Got to make people really believe that what they're doing is hugely important, that it really matters, that it's a privilege to do it and to do it with the others together with whom they'll work. And in our case, that the country actually appreciates what they're doing. Even if they disagreed with the policy we were implementing, they were grateful for what our men and women in uniform were doing. You know, we also, when I was the commander of the surge, the second year, every July 4th, we would have a big reenlistment ceremony. And the final year, we did the biggest reenlistment ceremony in our entire history in the military, 1,215 soldiers, sailors, airmen, Marines. I was the reenlistment officer, so we all have our right hand in the air. They're reciting the oath after me of enlistment. And I'm looking out at this group thinking, what is this all about? I mean, this isn't about the stock options. And by the way, they're re-enlisting in a war zone, knowing that because of that, they're coming back to a war zone. Because at that time, we were doing a year out and a year back, or sometimes longer. And all I could realize is that they feel enormously privileged to be performing a mission larger than self. And by the way, you all can craft what you do as a mission larger than self as well. They feel privileged to do it with others who also raised their right hand and took an oath at a time of war, which is pretty special. And they're conscious that those back home appreciate the sacrifices that they and their families are making. That is not, it's not impossible to replicate that in I think, in the private sector. And at the end of the day, that's what gets people to sign up, to stay, to be fired up, to attract others, to feel that what they're doing is of value and of importance. And look, I honestly think that you can do, great leaders can do that, whether it's at McDonald's or it's commanding the surge in Iraq. Great leaders can inspire people to take seriously what it is they're doing, always showing them that there's going to be opportunity for advancement, opportunity for growth, for development, for greater rewards, greater opportunities, if they do the very best that they can. And that's the key.
I think that's a great challenge for us.
Sure it is.
We are nearing the end of the prepared questions. I do want to let the audience know, General Petraeus will be taking questions. We are going to do it.
Bring it.
With the microphone. So I'm going to ask one more question, but while General's responding to that, if you guys would raise your hand, we'll have microphone runners around the room. Once you have a microphone, stand up, and then I'll point at you, and then we can ask the question. But maybe as a final question for me,
sure.
General, what are your thoughts on how the military deploys capital overall? What do they do really well, and where are there some opportunity?
Well, look, we have a capacity that is unmatched in the world for going into some place where we're not and building infrastructure, iron mountains, support facilities, actually just rebuilding countries. We were talking at the table before this about we rebuilt the oil industry in Iraq. I mean, I know more about 40-inch pipelines and all the rest of this stuff and floating terminals and fixed terminals and all the rest of this because we had to work through all that. I mentioned I called Jeff Immelt at GE in the middle of the night one time from Iraq and pleaded with him to bring his workers back because GE had had workers killed and they left. They weren't coming back. We're trying to rebuild their electrical infrastructure, electrical generating capacity. And we were doing it 5 and 10 megawatts at a time. These weren't gigawatt powers. The military has this extraordinary capability, and really no other country in the world remotely has that. And frankly, we've seen that, you know, Russia, for all of its military modernization and supposed professionalism and all the supposed training they were doing in Belarus and Russia on Ukraine's borders, all of that stuff, it's a lot harder than it looks. I did actually jokingly say, you know, it, because CNN was asking me and all the others, Fox and MSNBC and so forth, and I said, you know, if you're going to evaluate how another country invades a country, it helps if you've actually done it yourself. And our capacity to do that is pretty extraordinary. We should use it very, very sparingly. But what we've built up is really quite exceptional.
Great.
Questions? Who's got the first one? There we go.
I think this is on. General Petraeus, thank you for your service. My question is, we are polarized as a country, and it feels like every news article I read has a political agenda to it. Where do you get your news from, and how do you ensure you have an objective assessment of a situation?
I get it from a number of different sources. Literally sort of, you know, in the intelligence world, you have feeds, and feeds can be everything from human sources of information, signals intelligence, overhead video, with, you know, all it. So I try to have varied feeds, and they include everything from, you know, I still have a battle rhythm. I listen to NPR in the morning. I listen to the Economist Intelligence podcast, which is, I think, very, very good, very credible, very balanced. I go on all the different networks, so I get the views of Fox, which is one entire ecosystem and very different from MSNBC and CNN that would be somewhat more in the middle. I get input from the Washington Post, the New York Times, the other great newspapers of the world and so forth. So again, it's a whole series of these. And what you've got to do is synthesize it. And then we have a whole network inside KKR and all of our offices all around the world and then the relationships that I have around the world. And then I travel a great deal as well on top of that so that you confirm or deny what it is that you're being told and you see it with your own eyes. So, but you have to work at it very hard. There is no question that there is enormous polarization. There are basically entirely different ecosystems out there. And if you are only in one of those, you are not getting a full picture, I don't think, of what really is going on. And you need to be very, very conscious of the orientation, if you will, the political orientation of not just individual networks, newspapers, magazines, and so on. You have to understand the orientation of the individual reporters, particularly the most prominent of those who are on, again, channels like Fox and MSNBC in particular. Next question, please.
Thank you. So you talk about the relationship between China and the U.S. being, you know, a critical defining challenge for our generation. This group, this industry here, and other industries have made significant investments in China over the past decades and continue daily to evaluate new investments. What advice do you have for us in this industry and other industries as we consider that, given what we've seen happen recently in Russia, where with much smaller investment, you have basically stranded assets? And that's a challenging situation, especially for us making investment decisions in the future.
Yep. I mean, I will point out, by the way, that KKR, we actually de-risked our entire portfolio on Russia and Ukraine back in 2015, and we kept redoing that. That doesn't mean that we didn't have thousands of workers in the companies we owned in Europe in particular, but we had exit strategies for them. We had actually plans, emergency contingency plans and all the rest, and we basically sought to draw down our exposure. I'm not saying that that should be done for China, but it depends on the sector very, very much. And you've got to be keenly aware of the risks that are out there. We are actually going through a process of looking at three different scenarios of how the relationship could evolve over the years that lie ahead, and then determining what are the implications of that. And again, you have to be very, very conscious of the specific industry and company, of course, and how, what is its relationship with what is essentially now a surveillance state of the highest order. And you know, it's one thing to sell a commodity. It's another thing to be enabling, I don't know, collection of data that is used by the surveillance state or something like that. Now, the other bit of advice is get a very, very good law firm that focuses on the legal aspects of investing in China or selling in China or buying from China or taking investment from China, because the legal requirements are growing literally every month. There could actually be an outbound CFIUS process of some type. I don't think it'll be full blown. And we've been in conversations with Commerce Secretary Gina Raimondo, who's hugely impressive, former governor of Rhode Island, about that. You know, there is a process for the Committee for Investment in the Foreign Investment in the United States. I was part of it as the CIA director. We want to be sure that nefarious actors are not investing in crown jewels that we have or that would give them some kind of exposure to sensitive technologies, intelligence, what have you. There could be something going the other way as well. So my counsel, again, is to get much, much more serious about this. This is not the situation that we faced 10 years ago, much less 20 years ago, when we enabled China to enter the WTO, even though they really didn't meet all the criteria for that. It has evolved. Now, again, I have not given up hope that at some point leaders in Beijing will draw back from what it is that they have been doing in recent years and realize that, again, wolf warrior diplomacy, economic coercion, physical confrontation, intimidation, and all these other actions are self-defeating. But I'm not betting on that. And as a former intelligence chief, you have to look at the world through very, very coldly analyzing eyes. Next question, please.
General Petraeus, thank you for your service. If you had one option, a magic wand, you could change one thing with the military, excluding financial, what one thing would you change?
You know, we are, as Justin mentioned, facing a very serious recruiting challenge right now. And I think it's, as always, there's no single factor that explains why. I think it's the same tight labor market that all companies are facing. It is the fact that the number of Americans who actually just can meet the criteria, physical, mental, criminal background, whatever, just keeps going down. But it's also, I think, we're not at war anymore. And I'm not saying that people want just to come in to go to war, but when our nation was attacked, people's hands went up. And they wanted to, you know, they're like emergency response workers. You don't want an accident so you can demonstrate what you can do. But if there is an accident, you want to be there. I mean, I'd try to wave my wand and figure out how to resolve the human recruiting challenges, because if we cannot resolve that, and I mean, we're talking really down. We're talking down by a quarter or more in the U.S. Army. That is a gaping hole in your capabilities. And at the end of the day, it's all about people. As you all know, it's people, it's quality, not quantity, but you gotta have enough of high quality to do what we need to do. So I guess that's probably the single biggest challenge that is out there that I don't know how you'd wave a magic wand and resolve it, but if that was possible, that's what I'd do. We're actually funded quite well right now. Yes, I'd always love to see a bit more here or there, or some different programs. I'd like to see some of it used differently. We need to get away from the legacy platforms and into increasingly unmanned, AI-driven algorithm and all the rest of this. But it's really about people. That's the essence of a great organization. Next, please. Next question, please. I thought I saw someone.
Yes, sir. Right here.
Please. Yep.
So as technology becomes more and more important and pervasive in life and business and everything that we do, of course, we've seen growing. We see the bombs and the tanks and the traditional ways of fighting wars. We're also seeing more rise in cyber warfare, state-sponsored attacks. Just maybe your comments on what's going on there, how our country responds, and provide a little bit of color around how we continue to defend against and respond to those threats.
It's a great question. So let me offer a couple of points first. Number one is the war in Ukraine is actually not the war of the future. It's much more the war of the past. This is what we were preparing to fight when I was a major on the front lines of freedom, as we saw it during the Cold War on the inner German border. This is tanks, artillery, rockets. Yes, there are drones. Yes, there's social media. There are some significant advances, but by and large, it's very, very similar to what we thought we were going to fight. Second point is there's a sense, this is actually a myth, that Russia did not use all of its cyber capabilities. They did. They brought their cyber game. But the Ukrainians had gotten much better than in the past when their electrical generation was shut down one time, .gov site, we were all shut down, et cetera. We've helped them get that way. Our NSA, our other CIA and others have been very, very assiduous in helping them, as have other countries. And they also came after us. Brad Smith, the president of Microsoft, released a phenomenal report that shows the enormous amount of cyber warfare that Russia pursued, but it just wasn't very successful. We have gotten better. That doesn't mean we can rest on our laurels. We're still behind when it comes to cybersecurity as a nation. We're getting there. We have a phenomenal team leading the Cybersecurity and Infrastructure Security Agency right now, leading the effort in the White House. There's also a cyber czar for the first time. And then, of course, we have the traditional cyber command, NSA, FBI, CIA, et cetera. But that component has been present. That is different from what it would have been in the past, obviously. But it really has not materialized for Russia the way that we feared it would. And then finally, the war of the future is going to be completely different from this. Increasingly, it's going to be machine against machine. They may be remotely operated or piloted. It could reach the point where they are literally autonomous. And the person in the loop, you know, you always talk about you got to have the man in the loop for ethical reasons, and I'm committed to that. But the person in the loop may actually be the person who designed the conditions in the algorithm that the machine works through before it pulls the trigger. And maybe there's a point at which you say, okay, you can now let the algorithm run, weapons free, as they say in the air defense world. That is going to be a completely different world. And it will be not just on the ground, not just in the air, not just on the surface. It's going to be undersea. It's going to be in outer space, and it's going to be in cyberspace and in the electronic sphere as well. That is going to be a very, very different prospect, and we have got to get there first. We have to stay ahead of the others, because at the end of the day, what we want to achieve, once again, is deterrence. We don't want to have to demonstrate that we're better than they are in actual combat, because that could be so ruinous, especially if it were between two great powers. We're sort of seeing that with Russia, but it's very confined. It's limited in geography and also in what is being employed. We don't want to see what could happen. And so we've got to be prepared for that, and we have to ensure deterrence. So look, our time is up. I want to actually preempt, you're going to say thanks or something like that. I actually want to say thanks to you. And not just for the opportunity to be here on this stage with you and for the wonderful hospitality and so forth, I want to thank you for what you are doing for your service. You thanked me for mine, and I am now thanking you for yours. I have learned in the 10 years I've been in the private sector to have enormous respect and admiration for people who have built companies, who have developed companies, who have taken them from one level to the next, and particularly have done that in strategically important sectors of our nation. And I don't think there's any group that does that more impressively and more importantly in a more important sector than do all of you. So I want to say thanks to the ECC for what you continue to do for our country. Thank you very much.
Thank you, General. Thank you.